All right. So the reason that video is funny is because the guy barely does anything the whole song until he does that one wacky move, and the rest of it is just him just like going like this.
I like him.
I can't believe we got Taylor to come back on with us after that first show, man.
Yeah.
Nice to get you to slum with the little people, because I've seen
You guys are big. Y'all are big shots now, man. y'all are huge.
I've seen you with the Daily Wire. You're on with Jack Posobiec. I mean, I see you everywhere. You're on Glenn Beck. You're the guy, the go-to guy.
Hey, I'm just the dad with the webcam.
It is funny, though, because we watched... it really did start with McCarrick. That was the changing point, right? So
right.
With McCarrick, it was almost like a light switch popped in everybody. And you started talking about it openly. And it started a cascade of people just going, wait a minute, something's off over here. And you caught so much grief from everybody for speaking your mind, but it eventually got to the point where now they're jumping on Scott Hahn. And just to see this all come full circle, that they're all saying that Steubenville is now toxic, it's got to be a little bit of a wild ride for you even, right?
Yeah, I mean, I used to speak at Steubenville conferences, you know, Catholic Answers. There was kind of like an avatar of me before post-McCarrick, you know? I was just doing Catholic apologetics and writing books and speaking and all that. And then, yeah, that summer of shame with McCarrick. Well, actually, let me rewind a little bit. In 2017 is when I started kind of talking about Francis in a way that was like, you know, this doesn't sound right. You know, I don't know, like, you're divorced, you're remarried, you're living together, you're sleeping together. You can go to communion. I was like, whoa, you know, this is not fitting Catholicism. And so I started saying that out loud and people started jumping on me. And then when the McCarrick thing happened, I was just like,
just let it go.
Yeah. Let it go.
Just say it.
I was frozen. I was singing, let it go.
Yeah, because we talk, it's still funny because there are still people that are catching our shows and they'll hear us talk about the Latin Mass and they'll tell us this is their first time going to Latin Mass. But 90% of the people that we talk to and our audience and just at my local parish, everyone says, I started going to the Latin Mass because of Taylor Marshall, because he started talking about it. It was like you really introduced, because it was really a very niche thing with the SSPX. And if you had an FSSP parish, even when Samorum came out, it was really not a very popular thing until 2017, I would say.
Yeah. I mean, I can remember, I won't say what conference, but speaking at a conference, because I've been going to the Latin Mass. We joined the Fraternity of St. Peter Parish 2010. And I can remember, like, in those days, like 2010 to 15, like, they would straight up say, hey, we're glad you're here to speak, but just don't say you go to the Latin Mass, you know? Like, really? Even back then, it was sort of edgy, and it kind of signified that you were, like, a punk rock Catholic.
Wow.
You know, like... There was still an edginess about it. And so I think, you know, just the summer of shame and then COVID and everything that happened there, you know, people said, I'm willing to make a major shift in my Catholic walk.
Yeah.
What is it? And like, I just started saying, go to Latin Mass four times. You got to go four times. Because the first time you go, you know, it's like, it's kind of like the first time you taste beer or whiskey. You're like, I don't get it. I don't understand why people like this. This is not for me. But after like your fourth time, you're like, I kind of get why people like to drink beer. Like, this makes sense. And then after a while, so like once you've been to the Latin Mass, I think four times, maybe 20 times, you're like, whoa, this is a level of prayer. This is a level of worship that I've never experienced in like 20 years of being a Catholic or however long you've been a Catholic. And that really, you know, then just opening up, like, go to confession, pray the rosary every day, just like basic, what would have been basic Catholicism in 1900? Like, everyone on earth knows this. But somehow, since the council, we lost that. So I honestly believe that the Holy Ghost is moving and that all this has happened for a purpose. And on the other side of it, whether we three live to see it, it's going to make for a better, stronger Catholicism.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. Yeah. Not just that, I think even all of you converts from the 80s and 90s, I think the Scott Hahns, the Stephen Rays, all those guys, you, I think if you guys hadn't converted through your study of the fathers and all that stuff, I don't think you would have a fervent Catholicism that we have right now. I'm telling you, so
I think that's too much credit. I mean, there is already so many good priests and good I mean, there's so much.
They were hard to find.
It was, yeah. Let me piggyback on what you're saying. Okay. I think what happened is Catholic converts came into the church, and we read Thomas Aquinas, and we read all this stuff. We read the Council of Trent, and then we walked into the Catholic Church, and we saw the felt banners, and we saw people line up, and this, and kind of an irreverence, and like we were like seen in movies like Gregorian chant and altars and statues, and we walked in, it's just kind of whitewashed and lame and pedestrian for a lot of people, not all, but for a lot of people. And so what that caused is a lot of converts to have to dig down deep and explain to themselves and then all these other Catholics like, this is what it means. And I think that just led to the eventual turn to everything more traditional. And I think it's just going to ramp up even more. Like, people are going to be having a podcast in like 15 years from now, and they're going to be talking about what's even beyond what we are right now.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
I mean, I see it, especially with, okay, so I would say those guys that I mentioned before, the Scott Hahn, Stephen Rays, those guys taught me to love my faith enough because they taught me through apologetics and actually learning scripture and things like that, that when I was introduced to the Latin Mass, it finally connected for me where I said, oh, this is the religion I was learning about.
Yes.
Where there was this.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, the converts went through that. And then more and more people are experiencing all that. And yeah, it's just a shame that, you know, after the 1960s, there was this like corporate amnesia, not across the board, but and I would say most places, you know, most parishes, even things like novenas and Eucharistic processions and Marian devotions, and a lot of that stuff was, you know, mitigated, forgotten about. And you know, now we're seeing so much more of that on the parish level.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah,
that's good. It's going to take more.
Sure. Yeah, it's that whole, I really do think God was preparing something by having that mass conversion in the 80s and 90s, everybody learning their faith. And then it was almost like Benedict through Summorum. It just seems like an act of divine grace that Benedict thought to do that, even though he was stepping down in a couple of years. And I'm sure he knew he was. I'm pretty sure he knew what he was going to do. Or maybe he didn't, but either way.
I don't think he did.
Not back then, maybe. No, not in 07. So, but either way, it was like this act of divine grace where the traditional. So we basically, everybody was giving you grief, saying that you were causing this division and that the restrictions came down on the traditional mass because we were using the traditional mass as a point of unity instead of using the Pope as a point of unity. I don't understand the mentality of victim blaming, where people are seeking out tradition because they need some kind of an escape from the mayhem going on in the church. Had nothing to, I would say it had something to do with you just for simply talking about the Latin Mass, but I don't think you were the reason that it just seems so stupid to me that they tried to pin that on you.
No, I mean, it's a constellation of so many things. It's really ridiculous to think Taylor Marshall talking about Latin Mass on YouTube caused restrictions. It's silly, but you know, definitely you said there, Anthony, you said using the Latin Mass as a point of unity instead of the Pope. I would totally disagree with that. That's not at all. We should not be ever positing the Holy Eucharist against the Holy Father.
Yeah.
But that being said, our unity is chiefly through Christ and the Eucharistic sacrifice. And that's linked to unity with the Holy Father and the Pope, right? So actually our Eucharistic communion and our communion with the Holy See, the Apostolic See, I mean, I don't know if it's one and the same, but they're so deeply linked. And one of the problems is that since the 60s, you have so much liturgical variation and so much Eucharistic abuse and so many sort of, you know, liturgies that are made up on the spot by priests with their little interjections all the time, that that visible unity was broken, right? I mean, when I go to a Latin mass, I was in Atlanta last weekend, you know, and everywhere I go, like, I slip into the pew and kneel down, and it is the exact same. Might be different, you know, altar, a little different decor or structure, or the altar servers might wear black or red, whatever, but like, I can close my eyes and I know exactly where I'm at.
Yeah. And that is in, if you're in France or Germany, exactly. Or, I mean, it's the idea of having a universal language for the church is such a beautiful concept.
Yes.
And the idea that they would take that away. I mean, even without the traditional mass, what you had going on in your local dioceses, you would have your liberal parish and your conservative parish. So people were already getting away from this idea of a geographical parish because they didn't want to go. Right. If you're a conservative, you don't want to go hear some, you know, wishy-washy sermon anyway. So you start seeking out a conservative parish and you're already getting this geographical split because people were driving 15, 20 minutes away. Now, if I got to drive another 20 minutes beyond that to go and find a traditional mass, now you start getting these communities that are very intentional. Right. So when you go to a Latin mass community, every single person that attends that, they're not there because of geography. They're there intentionally because they take the faith seriously. So now you get these communities that are really vibrant and there's young people there that are taking their faith seriously. It's a whole different dynamic than I ever got at any local Novus Ordo parish.
Yeah. And, you know, we need to move towards the Latin mass being local at every single parish. You know, there is unhealthiness. I mean, I've been in the Latin mass circles for 13 years now. So, you know, I've been to a lot of places all over the world. And there is something difficult in that you meet someone after mass, like a cool dad and his wife and kids, and you have a lot in common. And then, like, you find out, like, you literally live, like, an hour and 45 minutes apart.
Yeah, he's an hour that way, you're an hour that way.
You're driving from the west, and it's like, we should get together. And it's like, but really, with kids and all that, it makes it really difficult. Whereas in a local parish, like, it's like, I'll walk down to your house. Like, in the Northeast, you know this, Anthony. Like, people used to say where they live, not by their, like, street name, but by their parish. Like, oh, I live in John the Baptist. Where do you live? Oh, I'm in St. Rita's, you know? And, oh, my cousin lives in St. Rita's. And people had this sort of neighborhood solidarity based on their parish. That is one of the things I think is not real healthy about travel life. We can't do anything about it because the bishop only gives us one place in an entire diocese. And so it's just sort of, you know, a magnet bringing all these people. But I think kind of the parochial normal life is impeded.
Yeah. Well, I think one good thing that I've seen happen is, and we even talked to, we talked to Bishop Schneider about this. We had him on a couple weeks ago. I asked him, I said, how is your opinion of the SSPX changed? Because I remember hearing sermons from FSSP priests that I would never hear now. Back then, you're talking before, like, right around when Summorum comes out, of them saying, don't you dare go to the SSPX, all these things. There was this deep division between the society and your diocesan or FSSP Latin mass that I think is going away, and you're starting to see an exchange of charity, especially just amongst the two different groups, where they're kind of saying, like, all right, you know, we have some differences, but we're kind of in a crazy time right now. Let's just forget about some of that stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I hang out with lay people and priests in both groups. And I think it depends on where you live. You know, I know of, you know, FSSP priests and SSPX priests that have dinner and talk, you know, and there, and then I know of other places in the country where they're, like, at each other's throats and it's not good. So, I mean, it's different everywhere, but I think you're right that especially since COVID, here's what I've noticed on the local level, not so much with the clergy. I've noticed that you're seeing a lot more cross-pollinization with, like, godparents with SSPX and FSSP.
Oh, wow.
I've noticed that. Whereas maybe, like, 8 years ago, you didn't really ever see that. Now you see it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And probably we'll start seeing, like, men and women from different communities marrying each other. You know what I mean? There's sort of these organic links.
Yeah, before happening. You would have like these communities that were very isolated, where I think there is starting to be a little more of an integration.
I think the internet's helped with it a lot.
Yeah, that's true.
Online dating.
I feel so bad for people dating and looking for a spouse these days, man.
Dude, it's rough, isn't it?
Oh my goodness, I couldn't imagine. So terrible. You see some of the stuff. We had Trent Horn on recently, and he was challenging me because I tend to push the moon landing is nonsense thing as a goof a little bit sometimes, and I know you've done this something similar.
Yeah.
And he tried telling me that. As Catholics, we have a responsibility to not make ourselves look silly and this and that. And I pushed back on him and I was like, wait a minute. I was like, you believe in evolution. Like, and to me, that's preposterous. I'm like, how can you say me not believing the moon landing is an equivalent to that? So he tried to put this responsibility, and I don't understand that. I mean, I get that you have a big following, but the idea that you can't say, over the last 10 years, my understanding of what a narrative is from the government has completely been shattered. I'm assuming you're in the similar boat to me, right?
Definitely.
Right? Like I don't know what I believe about 9/11 anymore. I don't know what I believe about the moon landing. They have completely destroyed my trust to the point where I'm questioning things that I never questioned before.
Right.
So for him to give me a little bit of nonsense on that, I started pushing back with evolution, because we had Hugh Owen on, who I never spoke to before, and he really challenged my, because I always just assumed the earth was millions of years old, and he kind of really threw some challenges up. So then I saw Graham Hancock on Joe Rogan again the other day.
Okay, I haven't seen it.
So Graham Hancock goes
I've seen the first appearance, and I've watched Graham Hancock's documentary on Netflix, and which, I'm familiar with him. I think it's interesting.
It is interesting because he goes in and starts talking about how archaeology has a narrative that they're trying to protect. Mm-hmm. And if you try to challenge that narrative, you get pushback, and they're accusing Graham Hancock of being a racist and all these things. Right. Now, he doesn't make the connection that the narrative they're trying to protect is that they can't let the biblical creation narrative stand.
Right.
So they have a timeline of things happened in this order, and civilization was built like this. We went from hunter gatherers to this, to this, to this, to this. And this is the gradual escalation, and anything that goes off of that narrative, they will push back very hard on. So he kind of just confirms that even more for me about the biblical creation story. Yeah. Where do you stand on it? Do you have a hard position?
You listen to the him on Joe Rogan, especially if you listen to him on the Netflix series, and it basically goes like this: well, there was this ancient advanced civilization that was far more advanced than we were, and they were able to accomplish these, you know, architectural marvels and move all these things and build all these things and align things with like the constellations and the seasons and the stars and all that. And then there was this big flood.
Yeah.
And after the flood, you know, people didn't know what to do. And there were these messenger prophet people, and they kind of guided the people into the truth because they were so lost, you know? And it's like, I've heard this story before. It's in Genesis.
It's actually our story.
And the very fact that they will not, that there's an ancient civilization that's advanced that gets wiped out by a flood, right? And that we can somehow, you know, we've had a hard time digging back into that lost excellence is the story of Genesis. And it's just, it's so amazing that you watch the entire thing and not once is there ever a reference to Genesis.
Not once. Yeah, because he won't touch.
He won't. So
even he has his own narrative that he's trying to not go near, right?
Right.
He wants to construct his own narrative that no, there was a civilization that existed, but we're not gonna acknowledge that there's actually a story that says there was a civilization and then there was a flood and then a new civilization popped up. It's really wild that people get stuck in there. So that's all that he the past few months have really been just me challenging my presuppositions about trusting anything from even the science community, especially after what they did to us with COVID, what they do with the trans issue, where I'm supposed to believe the same person telling me a guy in a dress is a girl. Right. I'm supposed to trust him on how we discover how old dinosaurs are and all that. I just don't trust any of it anymore. Yeah. I don't know.
Well, and think about it this way, TV and what we call online media, which is what we're doing right now. I mean, yes, TV started, you know, got popular in the 50s and in the 60s. But this whole idea of like mass media, that like Johnny Carson gets on the camera and talks to millions of people, or that hundreds of millions of people watch the same football game, and this whole thing, like, I think Trent Horn's a great guy and he's done a lot of good. He's very smart and all that. But it's like, should we as humans have maybe just like a 100-year moratorium, like of suspicion, yeah, that perhaps someone is using this mega Pandora box to deceive the entire planet? I'm not saying everything that comes off on social media or on TV is fake, but you have to realize there's been some really evil people in the world who have tried to deceive people. And now there's this mechanism by which they can televise all kinds of things. I mean, you know, have you seen the Joe Rogan clips where he's showing the atomic bomb explosions? Of those are all fake.
They're all fake. It's crazy. Fake. They show the truck there 1 minute and it's not there the next minute. It's unbelievable.
So we know that governments have used studios and they have used dissimulation and they have tricked the population. And so, you know, I think for anyone who's an intellectual and who's smart to question, especially if it comes from, like, I don't know, President Nixon or government officials, after we lived through COVID, I don't think that makes you like kooky, bad person, not intellectual, not professional. I mean, we're learning as we go year by year that all of these conspiracy theories, that a lot of these things are true. A lot of this stuff is legit.
Yeah.
You know,
I was going to say almost every military conflict we've been in since Korea, we found has been some sort of false flag. I mean, Gulf of Tonkin has been proved to have been staged. You know, obviously Iraq 2003. I mean, it's everything.
All these things. Yeah. I think Trent's main point is, he's looking at it like you might dissuade an atheist or a Protestant from considering Catholicism because they'll think we're kooks. But I don't think he realizes how many Protestants think evolution is nonsense and they're young earth creationists, and how many of them have been disaffected by the things that have come down through our government over the past 10 years too. And I just think there's different people are different, and I think we all sometimes people get audience captured where they see a certain comment in their feed and they assume everyone thinks that way. So I'm friends with somebody that works for Trent, and they would show me comments that would say stuff like, I almost became a sedative at Contest because of Taylor Marshall. And I would send him back comments saying, if it wasn't for Taylor Marshall, I wouldn't be Catholic today. Because there are different people have different tastes and need different things. And that's why I don't think there is this grand responsibility on you. I think your only responsibility is to actually say the truth to what you're seeing.
Yeah. I mean, we could just, like you said, you can just flip the tables and say, okay, well, you're promoting evolution. That's going to lead people to read Genesis in a non-theological way, and they're going to lose their faith.
Yeah.
You're making people, I mean, all of the, like you said, there's so many different people, so many different perspectives. I pray to God that as I study Catholicism and as I speak about it, that I'm on point and I'm on target. I hope that I am never, ever off in misleading people. And if I am, I need to repent and fix that, change that publicly. But I mean, for Catholic brothers in the space to be like, you know, knocking each other off or coming after each other over like super peripheral things.
Yeah.
We got it. We can't do that. Like, I think that's more scandalous to Protestants than anything else, you know, whether you believe the vaccine or, I mean, whatever, you know. I think we just, you know, let's keep things focused on the faith, you know, on the truth. That's what we're doing in this space. So let's just keep on keeping our lane and keep on it.
One of the coolest things I saw was you bumped into Matt Frad when you were in Lourdes and you guys took a picture together.
Yeah.
And it's like, people think we're so different, but it really, like, I hate tribalism. I really do. Like, right. I think anybody that believes the Orthodox faith and is struggling going through what we're going through right now, like, you're my Catholic brother, man. You may have some differing opinions on certain things right now, but I know you're struggling to handle. I mean, we're in a bananas time right now. That right. Like, I don't know what is going to come of this October meeting we just had. But it doesn't feel, I mean, everybody, you have two different sides saying two different things. One side is saying, oh, look, everything, they said they didn't get their agenda through with the LGBT stuff and the women priest stuff. But to me, I see it as that whole response to the dubia before the thing even started laid enough shaky groundwork that they don't need to do anything with that synod at that point. Like, that caused an earthquake.
Yeah.
Right. No, I mean, they basically
use the example. Let's say you're an SSA, same sex attracted adult man who's struggling with this. You're Catholic. You read this. You end up going to a Jesuit parish, you know, and you say, hey, I've struggled with this, but I just read this thing. I read the dubia responses. And then, like, yeah, I mean, that's what the Pope responded with. I mean, they are affirmed, whether some document with gilded ink comes out or whatever. We live in an age of mass media, and these things do make a huge impact in the lives of people. And it's a very uncomfortable position to be a layperson and say, well, this has always been wrong. It's wrong in the Bible. It's wrong in natural law. It's wrong in tradition. I have 30 Pope quotes. Yeah, but Pope Francis says, it's a very difficult question to say, well, I'm going to go with the tradition. And they're like, well, you think you know better than the Pope? That's a very uncomfortable position.
Yeah.
Right? But mm-hmm. So many of us are in that situation. It is uncomfortable. There's no way to make it go away right now. I think there will be a resolution in the future, but right now we just sort of live in this tension. And especially raising children and having families and trying to evangelize our family members and bring them to the church. That tension right there, I think, is the hardest thing about being a Catholic today.
Do you keep your kids isolated from that stuff?
No.
Your kids know about kind of the stuff that's going on in the church?
My kids watch my show.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, yeah.
See, I can't. My son, I'll talk to about it because he's 17 and he's older. My daughters, I don't even expose them to the mess that's going on. It's not that I'm trying to
isolate. How old are your daughters?
So 16 and 13. Okay. Yeah. And I just want to try and raise them in the faith the best I can. And I don't want them to know this mayhem's even going on.
Right, right.
And where my son, he understands, I have pretty deep conversations with my son about this stuff. But I think men and women are wired differently too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have a much easier time talking to men about the faith than I do with women. For some reason, I come off very brash to women. So I try to.
For some reason,
maybe calling them broads is a bad idea. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I can talk about things with my son that I would never talk about with my daughter. I kind of leave more those conversations with my wife to have with my daughters and stuff. So I didn't realize all your kids really do know everything that's going on. Wow.
I mean, I got eight kids, you know, I got 21 to age eight. Do my 8-year-old know about the Synod of Synodality? Well,
obviously. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Does my 10-year-old daughter know? No, they don't know that. But like, you know, my kid, it comes up, it gets in your face because, you know, like when my 19-year-old daughters, like when they turned like 13 or 14, they like realized, like, Dad, we have a lot of Catholic friends and they don't wear veils to mass. Like, have you been like tricking us? Like, what's going on here? You know? And so you have to have these conversations, right?
Yeah.
Or another one that comes up with all the kids that get older is like, Dad, I went over to so-and-so's house. They're all Catholic and they had burgers on Friday. Is that okay? Like, I always thought we don't do that. And so you have to explain to them, like, okay, well, there was this council and there were changes and there's
liturgy. My kid,
so like you get into all that and then they're like, well, why? And I don't know. It's just, again, it's not just like downloading every scandal that ever happened in the last 50 years, but you know, I don't think maybe most of my kids would know who McCarrick is. The older ones would know. Right. So we don't really get into that, but they know that there is kind of, there's different approaches right out there. And that when they meet someone Catholic, it's not always like the same flavor.
Yeah.
And we choose not to be like judgmental or anything, but we just kind of say, well, we kind of do things the traditional way, you know?
Well, it's funny. Cause my, even though I said, I keep them isolated from the scandals, but they definitely know there's a difference in Novus Ordo world and traditional Latin Mass world. Right.
Right.
That they dread to the point where when I first started taking my girls to the traditional Mass. So it's funny. My youngest learned to pray the Hail Mary in Latin by listening to you. Right.
Awesome.
So, I mean, this is when she was little. So she, when the first time you came on, she was so excited that you were coming on because we watched a lot of videos of you learning to pray the Hail Mary in Latin. So that was the first step. Then I bring them to the Latin Mass. My girls, including my wife, the first couple times I brought them was like culture shock. They were like, what is going on here? So it was that 2017 when you did go to four Latin Masses during Advent. It was like an Advent challenge you put out, you know? So we went to all four. By the end of Advent, nobody in my house wanted to ever go back to the Novus Ordo.
I know, right? It's the four.
The four in a row, it just, it's harder to go back to the other, to the Novus Ordo than it is to go to your first Latin Mass.
Yeah, I agree with that. Once it kind of settles into your bones a little bit and you start to flow in the Latin Mass, you know, you kind of get in, oh, this is what's happening. I've seen this. Then you're intrigued. Then you're hooked in. Then you're there. Yeah. Do you think women have a harder or easier time than men getting into traditional Latin Mass, traditional Catholic?
I think
I have some thoughts on this, but I want to hear your misogynistic take on it.
I think their initial, I think they have an initial like aversion to it. So I had this conversation with Keith Nestor too. He said the Latin Mass transcends gender. I don't think that. I think there is a very masculine, like a very masculine feel to the Latin Mass, which I think that's what attracts young men to it. It's shocking almost. And the fact that there's no women anywhere in the sanctuary, things like that. Like it does have a very masculine feel to it. But I think also that real femininity is attracted to real masculinity. And I think that by going to the Latin Mass, often even a woman who's been desensitized and has a little bit of that feminist ideology in her, she'll actually lose some of that by going to the Latin Mass. It almost instills a humility in all of us, right? So it'll instill that in a woman too. So I think her initial aversion is rough, but they seem to be, once they fall in love with it, really more hardcore than the men.
Yeah. I hear from a lot of men who are like, I'm going to the Latin Mass. My wife won't go. She went once. She won't go back. And I think the initiation, and of course, there's probably 1,000 women right now saying, no, I love it my first time. But I think that what you said is there's a little resistance, but once they get in, they're full on in.
Yeah.
My wife loved it the first time. It took me longer. And I think for me, it was because I was a cradle Catholic.
Mm.
So I had to like deprogram myself right from the way I was raised. Whereas my wife is a convert. And I think like what you were saying earlier, she noticed a disconnect with what she learned about the faith and what she experienced at the Novus Ordo. And when she went to the Latin Mass, it clicked instantly for her. Whereas I had to relearn my whole faith, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. I felt my first time going, it felt weird, but at the same time, I felt at home. It was a weird thing where it was alien to me, but I still felt at home. I really did. And it was a low Mass too. So I was confused.
Right.
I didn't even know it started yet. I was like, what's going on here? And I went in on accident to my first one. So my first one was at Holy Innocence. You've been to Holy Innocence. You met Father Mayor.
New York.
So I went in to go to confession on a weekday. It was like right after my reversion, and I wanted to go to confession on a weekday. I was working in the city and I found a parish that had 5 p.m. confession. I go in and right after they had a low Mass, And I was just like, what am I in? What is going on? I didn't know what. I thought I was in some weird prayer service. I didn't know what it was. But it was an amazing experience. I just left there asking a lot of questions. And I think that's how I found your podcast.
Yeah. So that's a great, that's a beautiful parish. If you're in New York, go to Holy Innocents.
I love Father Maior. He has done a lot of things that I can't mention on the air during the.
You just don't name them when you mention them.
Yeah. He did a lot for me during the incident back in 2020. But all right. And real quick before, because I want to talk about your fiction writing, because I read Sword and Serpent with my daughter, and I wanted to get you on to talk about that. And I know you're writing another one, but before that, what do you make of the Protestant dispensationalist obsession with Israel as a geographical nation?
Yeah. I've been talking a lot about that lately. Dispensationalism started in the 1830s by a guy named Darby. He was in Southwest England. And his whole idea was, okay, God originally was all about the Jews in Israel. But then most of the Jews in AD 33 rejected Jesus as the Messiah. So we Catholics have a very like clear understanding of what all that means and where it's going. And we can maybe talk about that, but he kind of said, well, God's plan A was paused and he entered into a historical parenthesis. That's the language they use, a parenthesis. And God turned on plan B, which was to save a bunch of Gentiles. And that's called the church. And then that was going to go. And then at the end of that parenthesis, God was going to rapture. That means suck all the Christian Gentiles off the planet Earth and go back to Israel and start dealing with the Jews again. And then the end of the world would happen. All right. So dispensationalism is these different dispensations. We kind of believe in Old Testament, New Testament, right? Basic. Yeah. They got all these dispensations and that's how they understand things. So it was a very small minority belief of theology in the mid to late 1800s, in the 1900s. But then in 1948, when they established the State of Israel, that sort of, they felt vindicated them. And so all of a sudden, you kind of started seeing other Protestant denominations, primarily Pentecostals, Baptists, and then it's really made its way into like the Bible churches and the mega churches, that God is now moving into this epic, this dispensation of restoring Israel. And it has to do with the state of Israel that we see right now. So there's this biblical, theological, infallible mandate that you must support Israel. You have to send money to them. You have to send guns to them. You have to send tanks to them. And it's Israel no matter what. And that's the dispensationalist belief. Catholics don't believe that. Yeah. Eastern Orthodox don't believe that. Not even Lutherans or Calvinists believe that. It's a very peculiar theology that emerged and was able to proliferate itself in America. Like, you get outside of America, it's not really a thing. It's an American, like, when I talk to European Christians, they don't really get it, but it's really an American phenomenon.
So to them, the incarnation, the passion, the crucifixion, the resurrection, that was all just plan B?
No. That was all plan A for them.
Okay.
But then Jesus rose again and they preached to the Jews and most of them did not accept it.
Okay.
So then you get to Pentecost, and then Pentecost for most dispensationalists is when God flips the switch and we're going to plan B.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. So how do you think a lot of our foreign policy is based on this wacky theology?
You know, Jerry Falwell was the one who really popularized it in America. He was always preaching it. And so it really, I don't think it affected foreign policy in America until maybe the late 80s and into the 90s. Yeah. Currently, right now, you know, like when I was talking to Glenn Beck, you know, he's like, you know, the fulfillment of the prophecy, Israel's here, support, you know, like, and he's Mormon, for crying out loud. You know, he's not even Bible church or whatever. So there is, I think it's really in the last 10 years, because what you've seen in the last 10 to 15 years is all the mainline Protestants who went to Methodist Church, Presbyterian, Baptist, all that, they have been sort of leaving that and moving into what they call Bible church or mega church. and it's kind of more comfy. The pastor's in jeans. He's got, everybody's got the coffee. You got the amazing praise and worship. It gets very polished, very American. It's very American, right? And so I think with that shift away from sort of the old line Protestant allegiances and into this new form of like laid back Christianity, it's also taken on this whole idea that to be evangelical, to be Protestant, to be Republican is to also believe in a theology, not a political policy or foreign policy, but a theology of Israel no matter what.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
It's crazy. So many.
Whereas,
so many
whereas for example, Pope Pius X, or was it 10th or the, no, it was Pope Pius the 12th said that, no.
It was
getting my Pius is mixed up. It's 11th.
Theodore Herzl.
Who says Catholics should not recognize the state of Israel.
I mean, it's funny how much things changed.
Right. because the idea that the boundaries of Israel are by divine right in 2023 because of dispensationalism is not held by historic Christianity.
Now do the dispensationalists believe that when Jesus does return, he's going to rule in the temple?
Yeah, they really want to rebuild the temple, but like the funny thing is like the Antichrist rebuilds the temple.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. So do you think
like, these people all like build the temple? And like when they're building the temple, I'm like getting my like hosts and wine and going into the catacombs because that's it. You know, like I'm not psyched about like that means the Antichrist is coming.
That's I feel like these people are being conditioned to like welcome the Antichrist. That's what scares me about it.
In the back of my head, that's kind of because, I mean, the Antichrist is going to unite the Jews and the Muslims and the Hindus and the Christians. So the guy who's going to, like, rebuild Jerusalem, establish peace, unite all these religions and all that, that's the Antichrist. That you don't want that guy.
Yeah.
We don't want that. It's going to happen, but I don't want to help him. I don't want to send him a check, you know?
Holy cow. And then before we get to it, you and Matt Gaspers, you would have Matt Gaspers on and you guys would actually do an impression where you would do your Jesuit Father Martin impression. And I created a parody account on Twitter, Father Marshall SJ, and it was hilarious. And then some idiot on Instagram stole it and put it on Instagram. You reached out to me like, dude, you gotta kill the account. You're like, this is, I don't know who's running this other one, but because I asked your permission when I first started. You're like, yeah, you followed it. It was actually hilarious.
Yeah,
man, those shows actually were
like the G Taylor. I don't know if that's really a problem. We have accompaniment.
So when did you write your first Sword and Serpent book?
That was in 2014. So we're coming up on the 10-year. Next year's the 10-year anniversary of Sword and Serpent. It's a trilogy. It's about St. George and the Dragon. That's the first book. And it's really kind of like a gritty historical fiction of what it meant to be like a poor Christian in the year 299. Right when the Diocletian persecution ramps up, the church is underground, the church is in catacombs, and people are being martyred. And like, what would it be like to be a Catholic where like people you know are being martyred? You don't have a priest anymore because he got martyred, you know, bishops are in hiding. It's a really fascinating part of our Catholic history. And I wanted to create a fictionalized, but historical, accurate, fictionalized story of what that would mean like. And I thought, who better? Because I started off me telling stories to my oldest son about St. George and the Dragon. He loved it, like chivalry and knights and all this stuff. And I would work in other saints into the plot who lived at that same time.
Yeah.
And a Catholic priest told me, he's like, you should like write this down into like a book, a novel. So I started writing that in like 2006. And it just kind of morphed over time and it turned into this magnificent historical fiction universe. And it's basically, you know, the trilogy is how St. George ultimately leads to the conversion of Constantine. And then how Constantine sort of sets up this pattern for Christendom and Arthurian legend and the sword and the stone and all these things that come after. And and Merlin and all these things. So it's kind of a fun story. And in St. Nicholas, who was during that same time, he's sort of the Padre Pio Gandalf mentor. Yeah. I really like him in the story. And so this year, you know, it's like we're coming up on the 10th anniversary. Let's do a short Christmas novel. And it'll be all about, well, you know, the story about Nicholas giving the gifts for the three daughters. Y'all know that story?
Yes.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, they're going to be sold into prostitution. So it's like another gritty story about prostitution and exorcism with Nicholas as the main guy. So it's like an origin story of how Nicholas became so awesome.
And how you have Arius in there.
Right when he starts to learn how he can like bilocate and like exorcise demons and like how he's really chosen by God to do amazing things. And of course, he's going to rescue these three young ladies who are in a very perilous situation with their father. And it's a really cool story. It's retold historically, and it has that sort of real life, you know, nastiness to it.
Well, the thing is, I read this with my 12-year-old daughter, and it wasn't a kid's book. Like, it's not a kid's book. It's not
right.
If anything,
but it's not inappropriate for.
No, it's not inappropriate. I'm saying it's either. Not a children's reading level.
No.
This is you will enjoy it as an adult. I loved it.
Especially if you like history.
Yeah, I wrote it for young adults, and I meet young adults all the time, and I'm like, can you sign my book? I love it. You know, and they're super psyched about it. But I've met probably more adults that have read it, even though that's not my original like intent. It really does have like a huge adult fan base.
Yeah, like the idea is we don't get that much Catholic fiction, right? Like we have Lord of the Rings, we have it's Tolkien and stuff, but every Catholic author comes out. I mean, even you have written how many nonfiction books, you know, just to you know, you're giving theology and things like that. But to get a Catholic fiction book is actually pretty awesome. Like, did you just do a lot of studying through history to get the ideas for it, or did you have this thing mapped out in your head already? And
yeah, I mean, like everything in there has to be accurate, right? So everything from the docks to the ships, if I mention a character who comes into the thing and they're a saint, like from history, they have to match that year. They can't be like 20 years before, 20 years after. Like it has to all be accurate. The swords. And, you know, you mentioned the Lord of the Rings. Like, I thought it'd be kind of cool to write a trilogy that's like Lord of the Rings, but it would be in our universe. And that's kind of the idea. It's like, there's just as much, I'm going to use scare quotes here, magic.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings or C.S. Lewis, or even, I don't like Harry Potter, but Harry Potter. But it's all like related to like relics and priests and monks and nuns and, you know, it's all this like supernatural, because you read like in the early church, like there's all these miracles and exorcisms and holy men and holy women and martyrs. I was like, what if you just stirred the pot with that in like a real story where these saints are on similar journeys and maybe bump into each other and meet one another?
Yeah.
And then you see them martyred. And then the whole idea of George slaying the dragon, and the dragon is just this it's the devil, it's Satan, it's the Roman Empire, it's Diocletian. I mean, I don't want to give the end of the book away, but it's really evil. Like what he goes up against at the end when he slays the dragon and he goes into this deep and dark cave, and he's like isolated and confronted with his own brokenness and his weakness, and you hear like the serpent voice, like just ripping him apart, like ripping him down and all that. I don't know. I get chills just thinking about it again. And it's just part of me, but I don't know. There's just something to me, like I've written like 14 books, and like people know me chiefly for like infiltration, right? That's mostly.
Yeah. Yep.
But
is that your bestseller?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's your bestseller.
But I feel like Sword and Serpent, book one, or if you do the whole trilogy, especially if you get to the end of book three, I think book three is probably the best of the three books. Like personally, I think like the best theology, the best teaching, the best everything is there. It's in Sword and Serpent, because it's, I don't know, like you really get to, I believe, get in a time machine and experience Catholicism in a trad way, but like a real trad way.
Yeah.
You know, like really.
Yeah, we did a show on St. Philomena recently. Like the early church had legit, more like St. Dennis running around with his head chopped off, right? St. Philomena, she drowned three separate times and she keeps coming back to life. The miracles that went on early on in the church that just made Christianity spread like a fire on the earth. I wonder if we'll get to that again. You know, it would be pretty amazing if we get to live to see the actual passion and resurrection, because I think you'll see miracles like you do in Sword and Serpent in the church in real life again.
Well, it said the last generation will have the greatest saints, right?
That's right. Yeah. The greatest martyrs will suffer more than the saints of the early churches. Yeah, I don't know. I think it's, and you know, you look back on, say, the last 100 years and you think, who has had the greatest theological impact on people? And I think, okay, God's given me this life. He's given me a calling. He's given me certain skills and talents. How do I take the talents he gave me and go 100-fold, like 100x? That's what I have to do, right? Like, hopefully God will use me to go 100x. And I was thinking, who's had the biggest impact? And, you know, it's really like, yes, there's like great theologians like Garrigou Lagrange and men that I admire, but you think of like C.S. Lewis, Tolkien, what they've inspired in so many people with regard to virtue and even with regard to the faith, it's pretty powerful. Mm-hmm. And it's because they're moving into a medium that hits hard. You know, it just hits different, you know, when it's Gandalf or Galadriel or what, it hits different. And I don't want to be presumptive, but I kind of wanted to be in that tradition and produce something hits different than just like a dad on a webcam, you know?
Yeah. But you also have a chance at capturing an audience outside of Catholicism, right? Like, I wonder how many people Tolkien converted with Lord of the Rings because they grasped the deeper concepts he was getting at of greed and, you know, things like that, that they actually, I mean, you see, everybody loves Lord of the Rings. It's not just Catholics, right? It's not a Catholic books per se.
But there's, but you know, we know as Catholics, when you read it, there's this sacramental understanding of reality.
Yeah.
And that's what hits really deep. And if you can show, same thing with Arthurian legend, there's this Catholic sacramentality that really hits the heart, you know, hits at a spiritual level. And you know, there's some great artists of our time. You know, I got to meet Mel Gibson a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
And, you know, the Passion of the Christ is definitely on that level.
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that movie's liturgical.
I mean, that movie is, he took the Stations of the Cross and he took the Passion of the Christ and he made an epic film that like hit atheists. It hit, it hit everybody. And so many, I mean, even in my own life, like I always kind of felt like Mary was more important than what Protestants said about her. And like thought, Mary's important. Like we should never dog on her. Like she's really, really important. But like when I saw the Passion of the Christ, I was like, dude, the Catholics have the Mary thing right.
Yeah.
Cause I saw it, you know, I saw it for like what it would have really been that she was standing there, you know? So, you know, that kind of artistic level, I can only pray to attain to, but, you know, we have to, yes, I write books. Yes, I do YouTube and podcasting and speaking and all that, but I don't know. I'm 45. I've got hopefully more years in me. I want to do more like documentaries, film.
That's what I would love to see, man. Some documentaries.
Like, yeah, I've got some like hard-hitting documentaries that I want to do. And I think it's just like a ripe time, and there's a lot of talented good people who are writing good scripts, you know, like we saw with, you know, The Sound of Freedom and even like just the crowdfunding with The Chosen and all these kind of
Mass of the Ages.
Pardon?
Mass of the Ages,
like all these alternative ways of funding cool projects. Like right now that's where I want to be. I want to figure that out and like hit people deep in the heart spiritually, and then hit a wider audience, like really get out there for people who have abandoned God, atheists, the people who are hurt, the trans people, you know, Protestant, everybody, and kind of come at the culture war from that more artistic.
Yeah, we're all waiting for you to start the Catholic Daily Wire, buddy.
Avoid that.
How did the talk with Kennedy go? You guys, you just saw Kennedy the other day, right?
Yeah, Kennedy and I were doing a speaking event in Atlanta. It was awesome. Great people.
I freaking love him, man. He is.
Well, we all got to get together. I know y'all had that event. I wanted to come. I just couldn't swing it. But yeah, Kennedy's cool guy. There's lots of great guys. Like next week, I got Jesse Romero's going to come in here. We're going to do an interview.
Yeah, he's great too.
And
I spoke at the canceled priest conference with Kennedy and Jesse. But I hung out with Kennedy that whole weekend. He was like my partner in crime. Like I didn't know anybody else there. So it was him and Eric Sammons.
I got to plug Kennedy, but he is the voice for Sword and Serpent. All
yes,
three
he
books.
Is.
He does He's a fantastic old. Job because he gives every character a different accent, a different voice. Yep. I mean, it's kind of almost creepy. It's like,
he's getting good, man.
How's he doing? He's doing women voices. He's doing Italian voices. He's doing Arab, you know, Middle Eastern, all kinds of stuff in the book. And one of my favorite characters is Saint Christopher in the book, Minas in the book. Mm-hmm. And he gives him kind of the Scottish accent too, which, I mean, there wouldn't have been a Scottish accent. Well, there wouldn't have been English at this time.
He's from modern day Turkey.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But just like it's his personality that he would talk like Mike Myers, Scottish. You know,
I'm listening to Murder in the 33rd Degree with him right now. He does Italian accents. Well, he does the same thing. It's really good.
So Kennedy, I listened to that book, Murder in the 33rd Degree, after listening to the trilogy, and Kennedy voices them both, and all of a sudden, I forget which cardinal it is. Diocletian's voice all of a sudden comes out of the mouth of like Cardinal Baggio or something. I'm like, well, what the heck is this?
Yes, exactly.
It throws you off.
Yeah, no, I had talked about him doing the voicing for the book, and then I listened to him do Murder in 33rd Degree, and I was like, yeah, he could do it. He could actually pull it off. And so contracted him and he did it. And it's really fun. I really like listening to his, it's a performance, really. Kennedy did a performance of it and it's pretty cool.
And it's cool for him because it forces him to read books that he might not have otherwise read. So he's getting a lot.
I loved it. Like, he was reading it and he like texted me like, I'm crying right now, man. I can't believe this just happened in the book, man. Yeah. Oh my God. You know, he's like getting hit while he's like performing it. That was kind of cool, you know?
Anytime his wife makes sauce, he texts me. He's like, look what my wife made. Look at my wife.
Makes what?
His wife makes sauce. Whatever. Like if my wife makes sauce or his wife makes sauce, we text each other pictures of it. He's my paisan up in Canada. But, oh man, Taylor, I love that you still come and hang with the little guys, man. Cause I know
hey man, you guys are big shots. Y'all are ballers now, man.
Well, Anthony talks big, cool. That's for sure.
Yeah, my ego's big. I don't know about our show. I have big dreams.
Hey, so what's next for Avoiding Babylon? What's next for you guys? Where y'all want to go? What's your next level?
Let me see. Next level.
We tend to wing things a lot.
Yeah, yeah. I said I don't know. We're gonna have to get on like Knowles or somebody. We're gonna have to get on, you know, do something like that. It's just a matter of exposure, I guess, right? I mean, you get enough exposure.
You think it is? I go back and forth on that.
I think content is king.
I have
good content.
Sometimes you'll just do like an amazing interview on someone's platform, and you're like, crushed it. That's amazing. And you're like, but it doesn't. It doesn't hit like where if you do really good content that goes viral. You know,
yeah,
I don't know, man. It's
if sometimes you hit a good interview and people just share it,
right?
People just share it. I mean, you can't beat that. Good content is king. We had Michael Hitchborn on, and we didn't talk anything about the church. He took us on through this theory that he has about what happened during the flood and Pangea separating really fast. And the reason we have mountains on the west coast of America is because the continent separated really fast because Iceland was a meat. I mean, it was this really amazing story. The thing starts getting like thousands of views in a week, and all of a sudden YouTube strikes the video, because at the beginning of the video we played a CNN clip of, it was like a fake CNN clip of like the girl hiding from bombs that didn't really come down or something. And we played a stupid video at the beginning, and they stopped that momentum. I was so mad, because I think that show really would have done well, man.
Well, if you had told me, we could have talked about Pangea.
Oh man,
gone viral. We'll say that now. On that
Pangea.
Listen to me. If you ever get the chance, because if you talk to Michael Hitchborn, have him come on and tell you about.
I've never heard him talk about this.
No, listen to me. Forget Lepanto Institute. Forget that. If you ever get, because I want this theory to get out. So, and it'll get out way better on your channel than ours. So if you ever have a chance to talk to him, bring him on to talk about that. It was the most interesting hour of podcast I think we've ever done, man. He just had everybody riveted. It was crazy. So, but Taylor, thank you so much for coming on, man. I'm going to let you fly. I know you got kids to take care of and stuff.
Let's say a prayer.
Absolutely.
What do y'all want to say? You want to say Latin, St. Michael?
Yeah, do the Hail Mary in Latin.
Do the Hail Mary. All right. Nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu in mulieribus et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus. Sancta Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in mortis nostrae. Amen. Nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen.
Thank you, brother. All right, Rob, you want to fly over to Locals? We'll take everybody over to Locals.
Okay, I'll play.
All right, Taylor, we'll see you, brother.
All right, bye, y'all. God bless. Adios.